Everybody thankful he's alive. Christ. We believe the Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. Hallelujah. He's coming back again. Come on, say it one more time. He's coming back. He's coming back again. And what can wash away my sins? What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can wash pure as snow? Welcome, welcome as a friend of God. Nothing but the blood. Everybody shout it. Come on, give him a hand clap and shout a praise this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, White Dove, you can do better than that. Lift up a shout of praise this morning. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, we're going to pick up kind of where I left off. From what I understand, Brother James stayed on the topic of the demonic assignment in our life and how he attacks and how he schemes and plans and things like that. But a few weeks ago, I spoke a message entitled, Shut the Door. Push somebody and say, shut your door. We want to keep the door shut to the enemy. We want to keep him out of our lives. And the way we do that, we know that the Bible teaches us, the reason we teach about sin in the church is not so that we can be judgmental, not so that we can try to control your life. It's so that we can let you understand that sin opens the door for the enemy to attack in your life. The Bible says that the enemy is a thief, correct? And he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Well, if you know there's a thief in your neighborhood, would you leave your door wide open? No. If you knew a thief was coming to steal everything you've got, you would close that door, you would put locks on it, you would deadbolt the door, you would set the house alarm, you would do everything you can to keep the thief out. And we live in South Arkansas, and so some of you would probably be packing on top of all that. All right? And so we do what we can to keep the thief at bay in our life. We don't want him to have access to our stuff. Now, that's the natural thief, but what about the supernatural thief who comes to steal your potential, who comes to steal your joy, who comes to steal your peace? He comes to steal your life. He comes to steal everything he can from you. He comes to destroy your families, your friendship. He comes to take everything he can away from you. And so we've got to keep the door shut and locked so that the enemy doesn't have access. Can somebody say amen? And so that's where we were a couple of weeks ago. And to save some of my voice and save some time, we won't recap too much on that. But today, we're going to talk about guarding your heart. Guarding your heart. Because this is another part, another area of keeping the door of access closed to the enemy. The Bible teaches us that it's very important for us to guard our hearts. In fact, the Word says in Proverbs 4:23, it says, above all else. Now think about those three words. Above all else. Look at somebody and say, that means it's important. Above all else, guard your heart. For everything you do flows from it. Think about that. Everything you do, everything that Travis does in life, everything that I do as a person, everything flows from whatever is in my heart. And how many knows that the enemy that comes after us, if he could do anything, he's targeting your heart. He's coming after your heart because he understands, he realizes if he can reach your heart, then he's contaminated the whole body. And so the enemy is after your heart. He's coming to destroy it. He's coming to kill it. And listen, people say, well, my heart's just broken. Well, how many knows that that's not God's will? The enemy wants to break your heart so that he can affect your whole being. So we've got to guard your heart. Look at somebody and say, better guard your heart. Demonic oppression may start with the mind. That's what we talked about a couple weeks ago, was how demonic oppression, he comes and he whispers things, and he comes to distract you, and he comes to annoy you. He comes to frustrate you and to get your eyes off of Christ. He comes and he attacks your mind. It may start there, but beware because it's headed for the heart. 2 Corinthians 10:5 says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought, everybody say thought, to the obedience of Christ. It's so important as Christians that we bring every thought into captivity. That means, everybody say, I'm a spirit. I'm not my thoughts. I'm a spirit. And so your spirit should have jurisdiction over your thoughts. Your spirit man needs to control your thoughts, because how many knows that your thinking can get you in a lot of trouble? Pastor Tom calls it stinking thinking. We gotta beware of stinking thinking in our life, because it may start as a thought, but many times thoughts are manifested in our life. And so you got to make sure that your imaginations are cast down. God doesn't want you living in an imaginary realm. He doesn't want your thoughts running away with you and leading you into the wrong places. So we've got to bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. That's why God says, I want your mind to be fixed on me. God wants us, our minds, to be fixed on Him and His purpose for our life. Excuse me as I suck on a cough drop this morning. Be careful of what is planted in your heart. The enemy operates just as the Lord does in the kingdom. The enemy scatters seeds, and he's hoping that some of them will take root in your heart. And this is why the Word says in Matthew 15:13, it says, "He replied, every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots." God is in the uprooting business. He says, hey, there's something growing in your heart. There's something growing in your life that I didn't plant there. How many knows that sometimes there's things in our life that we know God didn't put there? We did it. Somebody else did it. The enemy did it. He plants seeds. So there's a lot of negative seeds that are scattered in our life. But what we've got to make sure is that we do not allow them to take root. And so, yes, the enemy's going to scatter seeds. Yes, the world is going to scatter seeds. They do it as much as they can. They get things in your face as much as they can. They get things in your ears as much as they can. They scatter seeds, scatter seeds. People scatter seeds. But listen, you don't have to let them take root. You better be tending your soil. Somebody say amen. You got to make sure that nothing that is apart from the will of God takes root in your life. Luke 17:6 says, "He replied, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you." God says you have authority over those trees, over those things that have grown up in your life, over those hardships, the tree of bitterness, the tree of resentment, the tree of hatred, the tree of sickness and disease, all of those things that are in your life that shouldn't be there. The Bible says if you have faith as small as a mustard seed. In my office, I have a little jar of mustard seed to remind me of how much faith is needed to do great things in the kingdom of God. You can barely see a mustard seed. It's one of the smallest seeds. You can barely even see it. But faith that size can move mountains. Faith that size can uproot things in your life that shouldn't be there. And I'm just going to tell you, you're way too quiet this morning. It's okay, you can speak up. What starts out as a seed planted in the mind, if not dealt with, will grow into a fruitful tree that's planted within your heart. How many knows that hatred starts with a thought? Bitterness starts with a thought. Well, I can't believe they did that to me. And then if you dwell on it, then it's going to take you down a path. But listen, how many knows that resentment, doubt, fear, worry, stress, all of those things are birthed by a single thought? And the enemy knows that resentment, the size of a mustard seed, if planted and allowed to take root, will become very fruitful in your life. So you've got to make sure that the things, the seeds that are planted in your mind, that you do not allow them to take root in your heart. Your heart is a fruitful place. The problem with roots is that you forget about them. They are unseen. They're hidden. Well, I forgot about that. And how many knows that something can happen to you in your past and you really don't think about it and until you see that person again one day? And then all of those memories flood back in your mind. All of those thoughts come back. All of those feelings come back. And so what you've got to do is you've got to make sure you pull it up by the roots. That way it never comes back. You've got to pull that thing up. You've got to dig so deep into forgiveness that all of those things come out. And you don't want to hold on to any of those things. Listen, you cannot ignore things like unforgiveness. You can't ignore things like resentment. You can't ignore things like hatred. You can't ignore things like fear, because eventually it will come to the surface. Psalms 51:10 says, "Create in me a clean heart." That's what we want. "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Listen, God is there to help you cleanse your heart, to help you cleanse it from all the things that separate you from from His perfect will in your life. All the things that separate you from perfect peace, He's there to help you cleanse your heart from those things. Now listen, beware of what your heart is feeding on. Beware of what your heart's feeding on. Psalms 119, verse 11 says, "Your word I have hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you." The word of God nurtures your heart. It nurtures your heart. It's the food that you need. It's what sustains spiritual growth in your life. It's what sustains maturity in your life. And so we need to feed on the Word of God. Proverbs 4, 20 through 27 says, and this is our primary text for this morning. We're going to reference this a few times. It says, "My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your," everybody say ear. "Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them and health to one's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it." Keep your, somebody say mouth. "Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. And let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths of your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or left, but keep your foot from evil." We've got to guard our heart. The Word says, above all else, guard your heart. You guard your heart with your ears. Say it again. Ears, your mouth, and your eyes. These are gateways to the heart. And we've got to be very, very careful. So let's look at the ears first. The ears, what you listen to has the power to nurture or destroy your heart. What you listen to has great power in your life, and it can build you up or it can tear you down. There is music out there that will build you up. Can somebody say amen? We listened to worship music on the way home yesterday, and it just filled the atmosphere with peace and good things, and it was just a great, great time. And so there's music that you can listen to that really builds you up. But how many knows there's also music out there that can tear you down? It can tear you down. There's that song by Underwood, Carrie Underwood, something about slashing somebody's tires and beating up their truck and, you know, and all that stuff. You know, that song probably doesn't lift anybody up, right? It probably tears you down. And so you got to be careful what you listen to. There's music out there that you can listen to all day long that will tear you down. But listen, it's very important that you guard your ears. Because what comes in must go out. And the Bible says, out of the heart, that's where everything comes from. And so whatever you listen to, it is making its way to your heart so that it can come out. It's like a cycle. So we've got to guard our ears in order to guard our heart. Proverbs 4:20 says, "My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words." Be aware of who is speaking into your life. It's very important because there's a lot of people who would love to speak into your life. There's co-workers who would love to speak into your life. There's family members that would love to speak into your life. Listen, the world would love to speak into your life. The news and the media would love to speak into your life in order to alter what you believe about certain things. Listen, there are plenty of people in this world who would love to speak into your life. And can I say, there's a lot of preachers who would love to speak into your life. There's a lot of ministers that I won't listen to because what they're speaking is not true. What they're speaking is lies that are formed to please your ears. And so you got to be careful of who's speaking into your life. Be very careful that you're not listening to the wrong people, because what comes in must go out. Romans 16, 17 through 18 says, "I urge you, brothers and sisters, to watch out for those who caused divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teaching you have learned. Keep away from them. These are people who grumble, who complain, who murmur. You want to stay away from those people. Listen, be sure that you're not spending your time with complainers. You know why? Because complainers breed complainers. Because what comes in must go out. So you got to be careful that you are not spending your time with people who cause divisions among the body of Christ. Verse 18 says, "For such people are not serving our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. By smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the minds of naive people." You've got to be careful who you're listening to. Luke 8:18 says, "Therefore consider carefully how you listen." The Word is full of scriptures that deal with how we listen, who we're listening to, what we're listening to. We've got to be very careful what we allow our ears to hear. Mark 4:24 says, "Consider carefully what you hear." Consider carefully what you hear. That should be what you listen to can build, not what you listen to. What you listen to can build your faith or your fear. How many knows that your faith can be built up by listening to the right people? Your faith can be built up by listening to the Word of God. This week, my faith was built up. I was sitting in a room with my uncle who has been serving God all his life and been pastoring for decades and decades and decades, and he's in a wheelchair now. He's getting older, and he's in a wheelchair. And he said, "You know what I did Sunday?" I said, "What'd you do, Uncle Jimmy?" He said, "I preached the Word." He said, "I don't know anywhere in the Bible that says you've got to stand up in a suit and tie and preach the Word." He said, "I preach from my wheelchair, you know." And so he preached at his church. And, you know, but your faith is built by that. Your faith is built by people who are serving God. And listen, you want to surround yourself with people who will build up your faith, who will give you a little push to believe for more, who will give you a little push to believe that there's more in your life, to give you a little push to believe that the best is yet to come. You don't want to be around people who are complaining and discouraged and defeated and depressed all the time. You want to be with people who will push you into life, push you into life. And that's what you need to be careful. Be careful that the news and the media is not feeding your fear, but feed on the Word of God, because it will bring life. Romans 10:17 says, "So then faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." Make sure your ears are hearing the Word of God. Oftentimes we have things playing in our car. It's just messages and scriptures and things like that that will feed our faith. We want our faith to be fed, not our fear. Create an atmosphere of faith in your life. Create that atmosphere. Make sure it's not contaminated by the things of this world. Make sure it's not contaminated by the negative influences of the media. Be sure that the atmosphere in your life is conducive for faith, and you do that by hearing the right things. Can somebody say amen? So we've got to guard our heart. And the second thing, we got to guard our ears, but we've also got to we must guard our mouth. We must guard our mouth. Proverbs 4:24 says, "Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips." This was from our key text this morning. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. You got to be careful of what you say. Psalm 19:14 says, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." I love that it put these two things together: the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart. How many knows that a lot of times your thoughts are based on what you're saying? You're thinking about what you've said. You're thinking about what has come out of your mouth, and eventually it's going to take root in your heart. You can say something, and you may not even mean it at the time, but if you ponder on it long enough, then you're going to believe it in your heart. It's going to take root in your heart, and it's going to produce a harvest whenever it matures. So we've got to be sure that we're being careful of what we say. You say what you think, and you believe what you say. You say what you think, and you believe what you say. Let me show you this real quickly before I expound on that. If you say something enough, you're going to eventually believe it. You know, when you went fishing and you caught the fish this big, you know, little bluegill or something, and you go back and you're like, oh, yeah, man, you should have seen them. I was catching them. Oh, that must have been that big. And then the next time, oh, man, we were catching fish. You're not saying they were that big. You're just saying, we were catching fish, you know. They're like, oh, man, where did you catch that? You know, and if you say it long enough, guess what? You really think you were catching fish because you said it enough. There are stories that my grandparents would tell me that I knew there's no way it could be true. But they believe it. They believe it because they've been saying it for decades. And so if you say something enough times, you're going to believe it. So you got to be careful what you say. There goes my cough drop. On the floor. You don't have to say anything. That's a right and a privilege that you have as a person. You don't have to say anything. And we know that Proverbs 13:3 says, he who guards his mouth preserves his life, but he who opens wide his lips shall have destruction. And so you don't have to say anything. There's times in your life where the best thing for you to do is just to shut up. Just be quiet. You don't have to say anything because whatever you say, it's a trap. It's a trap. There's no good response. And so there's times in your life where you just need to zip your lip. Look at somebody and say, zip it. If you can't say something good, don't say anything at all. And so you got to be very careful because the enemy will operate through your lips if you allow him to. James 3:6 says, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature and is set on fire by hell. Your tongue can contaminate your entire being. Be careful of what you say. James 3:9 says, with it we bless God, our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the likeness of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not be so. We've got to be careful that we're not contaminating our entire body, contaminating others, contaminating the body of Christ by the things that come out of our mouth. Things that seem harmless can do a lot of damage. People smoke all the time in the midst of drought, right? And it's harmless. But how many knows the wildfires are set on by one cigarette butt that was not put out properly? Amen? And so you just got to be careful. People burn leaves and stuff when they're not supposed to. Seems harmless. People swim with sharks. Seems harmless at the time. But listen, you got to use your mind. You got to use your brain. God gave you a brain. So just zip it. Somebody say, zip it. Where do our words come from? Somebody tell me. Our heart. We're guarding our heart. Luke 6:45 says, a good man out of the good treasures of his heart brings forth good. And an evil man out of the evil treasures of his heart brings forth evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of what you have fed your heart. Listen, if you're feeding on negativity in the news, guess what's probably going to come out of your mouth? Negativity. If you are feeding yourself on the things that your fears are based off of, guess what's going to come? You're going to make people afraid with your words. But listen, if you're feeding on the Word of God, guess what's going to come out of your mouth? The Word of God. If you're feeding on faith, guess what's going to come out of your mouth? Faith. And so you want to make sure that you are spewing faith rather than fear, anxiety, worries, distress, distraction. You want to make sure that you are speaking the right things in your life. Because what you think, you speak. But what you speak, you believe. Can somebody say amen? Matthew 12, 34 says, "Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same spring?" This is James 3:11. Listen, you can't do both. You can't speak both faith and fear at the same time. It's one or the other. And so you got to make sure that your words are saying, that the words that you are saying is uprooting the evil in your heart. Uprooting the evil and building up the faith that is stored up by the Word of God. Are the words you are saying nurturing faith? Are they building your faith? Let me ask you this. Are the words you're saying, is it building the faith of other people, of other brothers and sisters? Is it building faith or is it building fear? We've got to guard our heart by guarding our ears, by guarding our mouth, and lastly this morning, by guarding our eyes. You've got to be very careful of what your eyes are looking on. We've got to guard it. Proverbs 4:25 says, "Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you." This was from our text. Fix your eyes, fix your gaze strictly, directly ahead of you. Your eyes feed your entire being. That's why the Bible says, keep your eyes fixed on me. Keep your eyes fixed on Christ. Keep your eyes fixed on the prize that's set before you. Keep your eyes, you got to stay set. You've got to keep your eyes from distractions, because how many knows that there are a lot of things that can distract your eyes? Junior, I'll pick on you. There's some fine honeys that can distract you by catching your eyes, right? Koisha, there's some fine hunk of man that if you'll let him, he's going to distract you, right? Right? Right, Nick? And so some fly honey. Oh, man, that's some blush there, some red. All right. And so... So look, there's a lot of things that can distract you. Listen, there's DirecTV has hundreds of channels that can distract you, right? Right? And so I'm not preaching against TV this morning, but I'm telling you that there's a lot of things in this world that can distract your eyes, but your eyes contaminate your whole, like the mouth. The eyes is like the gateway to your soul, and it says it like this in Matthew 6:22-23. The lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. So you want to make sure that what your eye is seeing is bringing light to your body. Because if you're not, guess what? You're going to have a body full of darkness. And so you want to make sure that you're lighting a fire in front of your eyes, that you're feasting your eyes on the Word of God, feasting on things that build your faith, like all the goodness that God has created. You want to make sure that your eyes are beholding the things that God has created for your good. It says, but if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? If your eye is good, your whole body's good. Your whole body. And so you got to make sure that you are closing the gateway to the enemy. That you're keeping the door shut by what you see. That you're keeping, you don't want to unlock things in your life that shouldn't be there. I believe I've shared this story in the sanctuary. I know I have with youth. But there was a movie that me and my friend, we watched when I was a teenager. And it was called The Mummy. Anybody remember that? It's not a trick question. I watched it. And so we watched The Mummy, okay? And it seemed harmless to me at the time. And we watched it, and then after it was over, there was a sense of it wasn't a scary movie, it was just a movie. But there was a sense of fear in our house. And I couldn't, it was like somebody was walking behind you as you were walking through the house. Has anybody ever had that feeling before? Yeah? Okay? And so just the eeriness, a bad feeling in the house. And I went to sleep that night, and I had a dream. And I had a dream that we were watching The Mummy, that we were just watching the, watching on the TV. It was like I could see myself watching the movie. And out of the TV, it had little vents on the side of the TV, like little air vents on the side of the TV. And out of the vents, evil spirits were just flying out like that into the house. Just like that. Now I'm not saying that's how it happens, but I'm telling you that we opened a gateway for the enemy to work in our home. And so, you know what we did? We went and threw that movie in the trash. We didn't watch that again. You know, whether it's bad or not bad, for me it was bad. And so we went and threw that joker in the trash, and we said, we are not going to allow this to contaminate our home. There was also a video game that we played that was opening the door for the enemy, you know, to operate in our home, and we threw that in the trash. You know, and so we have to understand, we've got to be very careful what our eyes are seeing. Because your eyes open a window to your soul. Your eyes open a gateway to your body, to your atmosphere. And you got to make sure that that door stays shut. Now push on somebody and say, shut the door. This is why you must be very careful what you watch. Lust, anger, bitterness, selfishness, doubt, and fear are all fed by what you see. It's all fed by what you see. We know that lust is birthed by pornography, even by hamburger commercials nowadays, right? And you can't watch anything without them pushing lustful thoughts in your view. Anger is breeded by the news and media, bitterness and selfishness. Selfishness is created by HGTV. You always want something more. You always want something better. You know, I mean, I'm just telling you that what we see breeds things in our life. And so I'm not saying never watch TV, but I'm saying you better be careful that you're feasting your eyes on things that are building your faith. Can somebody say amen? Matthew 5:29 says, if your right eye causes you to sin, pluck that joker out, cast it out from you, for it is far more profitable for you that one of your members perishes than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Psalms 101:3-4 says, I will set nothing wicked before my eyes. I hate the work of those who fall away. It shall not cling to me. A perverse heart shall depart from me. I will not know wickedness. But I love where it says, I will set nothing wicked before my eyes. Do you have that resolve? Do you have that resolve in your life that nothing wicked will be set before your eyes, that you will not look upon anything that will cause you to stumble in your life? This is why we must fix our gaze. We must fix our gaze. Hebrews 12:2 says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. You want your eyes to be fixed on Him. You want your eyes to be fixed on Him. I remember there was a time in my life as a teenager where I was at a crossroads and I didn't know what to do. And I went and I laid down in the floor of my bedroom, and I said, God, I'm not getting up until you show me what to do. I'm not getting up from this spot until you show me what you want me to do, because the decisions I was getting ready to make was going to affect me for the rest of my life. And I laid there, and I decided I'm not getting up. And I laid there, I think it was for hours, and then God showed me one picture in my mind. One picture. And that picture set the course for my life. I'm telling you today that I would not be standing before you preaching the gospel today if it were not for that thing that God showed me. And my life would be totally different today if I had not obeyed the one thing that God showed me. Listen, it's very important that you fix your eyes on Christ, because there's plenty of stuff out here that will distract you and lead you astray if you let it. The enemy's out there flashing, bling, over to the side, and it catches you in your peripheral vision. And if you do this, you're going to be headed in the wrong direction, because God says, no, I told you to go that way. I told you to fix your eyes on me. I called you to walk the straight and narrow. I didn't tell you to go to the left or right. The Word says, don't you go left, don't you go right. You keep your eyes fixed. You keep your gaze set on the things that God has for you, and He will never lead you astray. That's the God that we serve. Can somebody say amen? All right. So we've got to guard our heart. And lastly, this morning, by guarding your ears, your mouth, and your eyes, you are keeping the door of your heart shut to the enemy and open to Christ. That's what we want for you. That's what we want for you here at White Dove. Worship team, if you'll go ahead and come. It's a little early, but we'll go ahead. That's what we want for you. We want the door of your heart, the door of your life, the door of your spirit to be shut to the enemy. We don't want him to have any access. We don't want him to have any access in your life. We want the Holy Spirit to have free rule and reign in your life. But listen, the door is either going to be open to the Holy Spirit or it's going to be open to the enemy. But it's not going to be both. They're not going to use the same door. You're going to open it to one or one or the other. And we want your whole body to be full of light. We want your whole being to be full of the things of God. We want you to be full of faith, not fear. We want you to be full of the things of God, not the distractions of this world. When we preach against sin, when we preach hard messages, listen, it's because we know that there's better for you. We know that there's more for you. We know that you have access to so much more if you will just open the door to the things of God. Let's stand this morning. All right, look at somebody one more time. Push on and say, you got to shut that door.
Someone said, a boy is a loud sound covered in dirt. But is that really true? God wants boys to be boys. The church's job is not to hardware them differently, but to instill biblical software into their lives that will channel their natural assertiveness, competitiveness, and yes, loudness in a manner that honors Christ. As the church instills biblical principles of manhood and servant leadership skills into the lives of boys and young men, God-pleasing husbands, fathers, and world changers will emerge. Boys emulate men they admire and respect. The Apostle Paul instructs that godly men in the church play a role in bringing boys into biblical manhood, Titus 2, 6-8. The process starts ideally in a loving home and is reinforced with the active involvement of godly men. If we could take their motto from 1 Corinthians 11:1, it would be, "Follow me as I follow Christ." Men working with a purpose. Royal Rangers provides a ministry that is designed to encourage the men in your congregation to model the principles Jesus taught and be involved in service. It rallies them around a biblical cause. It provides them the resources to enjoy ministry success while developing much-needed bonds of friendship with other men. Royal Rangers is fun for both men and boys. To facilitate the mentoring relationship, Royal Rangers exercises the interest men and boys already have, like outdoor and sporting activities, trades, technologies, and art ministry. Royal Rangers uses proven mentoring resources to help boys become godly, confident, wise, and compassionate leaders. Royal Rangers is fun with a purpose. By intentionally developing the mentoring relationship, Royal Rangers equips the next generation of men, husbands, fathers, businessmen, and church leaders, and empowers them to be lifelong servant leaders. The boys and young men just think they're having fun instead of being discipled. Royal Rangers equals evangelism and discipleship. Yes, it's true that boys are often loud and covered in dirt, but boys don't have to be quiet and clean before coming to Christ. He can turn dirty noisemakers into articulate proclaimers of truth. He can prepare them to take the gospel to the next generation. All it takes are willing men to engage in meaningful mentoring relationships with them, influencing more boys and young men than ever, more effectively than ever. Royal Rangers, evangelizing, equipping, and empowering the next generation of Christ-like men and servant leaders.